What's up, guys? It's Lady Calysta. Today I'm going to be talking to you guys about Game of Thrones Conquest. Now, for those of you that watched the other Game of Thrones video that I have on the channel, you may or may not remember that I had mentioned I played the wrong Game of Thrones game thinking it was the one that was nominated for the Game Awards. And it wasn't. And this one kept getting advertised to me on Facebook, on Instagram, like all over the place. And I ended up downloading it and I played it for like a week before I realized I was playing the wrong one. But I love Game of Thrones. So I'm not gonna lie to you guys. Like, I do. I love it. I'm a huge nerd. I just love it, love it, love it. Like, I'm doing the hair today again. Like, I'm just like ridiculous, right? So wanted to let you guys know kind of how the game was going because I've kept playing it. So I am in Guild Omega. It is an awesome alliance. It is pretty much the strongest alliance in the server. We have 108 members, and what I'm showing you guys here is kind of the alliance view, and those are called Seat of Powers, right? So Winterfell, for example, is a Seat of Power. And you basically fight for these when they get unlocked and you get all these buffs. Now, think of a Seat of Power almost as a fort, right? That provides a lot of different buffs, not just like one or two. And you can see another example there. That's the twins. So the Seats of Power are all kind of like different. And you can see I have a title, how cute. I was really excited about that because I normally don't have a title. So I wanted to show you guys that. So what I'm going to be doing with this video is I'm going to run quickly through it, through the things that are like womp womp, you guys know it, a lot of you are all like hardcore, like you've played Lords Mobile, you've played Iron Throne, like you know this genre of game in and out. So of course there's resources, right? Like, big surprise there. Of course you're going to be focusing on building and leveling up and getting your buildings ready. Like, of course there's four types of troops, right? There's like your basic ones like infantry, range, cavalry, and siege, and then you can make traps. So what I want to focus on instead, in a little bit more detail, is not that kind of stuff. I kind of just summarize all the stuff that you need to know as it relates to that, but more so the stuff that makes the game different from your traditional typical type of game that looks like this, right? So here I'm showing you guys, there are 10 types of troops here, right? So 10 tiers, I should say. Right now, I've unlocked tier 6, and I'm primarily free to play, but I am in an alliance that does have a lot of huge players, right? And the only way to get alliance gifts, so this is an asterisk, something different, the only way to get alliance gifts in this game is through people actually purchasing packs. So that's pretty different, right? So I could hunt monsters all day long. It does not mean my guild is getting a bunch of gifts from monster hunting. Wanted to show you guys, this is called the Shrine. And for those of you that are fans of the Starks and the North, you absolutely know what that is, right? That white tree right there. It is pivotal, right, in the Game of Thrones lore. You're able to basically make a certain number of wishes per day. And those wishes, you can decide what they are. It can be free wood, free food, like different things. Another thing that's different is everybody starts off with a dragon, regardless of whether or not you're a Targaryen. So everyone gets the benefit of the dragon. The dragon can do a variety of different things as it matures. Right now, my dragon is a whelp. I am showing you guys here, you're supposed to feed your dragon, right, every day. And you monster hunt to basically get different types of food that you can then give your dragon. And the more food you give your dragon, that's kind of how you level him up. But in addition to that, you're also getting, every time you level him up, talent points, very similar to those of you that are familiar with other games, the way you would give your hero talent points. In this case, you're giving it to your dragon, and there are different kind of buffs and things that you can do, and there, it depends on whether you have an adult dragon, a whelp, etc. You can see right now he's a whelp, but I did, because I am, and there's also research. I wanted to mention that there's a Maester's Tower where you do research, and in this case there is literally dragon research, and you unlock it so your dragon can do different things, right? Attack creatures, help you with gathering. I did, in my true nerd fashion, videotape my little hatchling being kind of moving from being an egg. First he starts as an egg, and then he becomes a hatchling, right? That's when he's a hatchling. Then I got him to a whelp, so that's where I am now. I mentioned the Maester's Tower. I thought that was a really nice touch, right? Like, Maesters, they're kind of like the intellectuals of the Game of Thrones universe, and your Maester's Tower is where you do all your research. Now, you're noticing I have been hardcore focused on moving my military research, right? Given that I am in one of the biggest alliances in the server, we are in constant war with the other alliance that's, you know, pretty close, if not just as big as we are. And even though there are things like kingdom rules, which I wanted to mention to you guys while I show you guys the events here, there was a kingdom rule when this first started, and this is across all the servers, right? So this isn't going to be a game where you're constantly jumping servers. Doesn't happen, right? Like, you have all these new servers coming up, then they do this big merge, and that's it. You're stuck there. You're not migrating from server to server. So that's a big thing I wanted to call out. Super different, right, from a lot of the games that I tend to play on this channel. Also, another thing to mention is when we first started, there was all this kind of talk about like kingdom rules, and it was the first time that I had heard of kingdom rules, and I've played a lot of these games, and the kingdom rule was basically you cannot attack a player unless they have over 1 million in resources. You can see there, I'm getting a whole lot of resources from the fact that I completed a bunch of quests, a bunch of the bigger quests. So that it holds unless you're at war, right? So if you're in a really small alliance, for the most part, people will try to leave you alone. But if you're in the bigger alliances, the ones that are truly warring at all times, that 1 million rule just goes out the window. And I've spoken to people in other servers, and they say that usually it always starts off that way, but eventually you start having people break it. So people are taking screenshots, and it becomes like this whole thing. I thought that even the thought was amazing, because you guys know in some of the other games like Lords and Iron Throne, like they don't care. There is no like any of that. There aren't any kingdom rules. So because I am actually tiny in my alliance, I'm considerably probably the smallest. I don't know, probably close to the smallest. I am constantly having to be really careful with my troops. Now, I'm not shielded. Shields here cost quite a bit, and I wanted to prove the fact that, you know, is the game kind of pressure tested? Can you play this game without spending a lot of money? And yes, you can, but you need to be in a strong alliance. So the fact that my alliance is so strong, we hold a ton of seats of power. When I was scrolling in the beginning, you saw that. So what I'm able to do is basically send my troops to those seats of power to basically protect them for 24 hours. So it almost takes the place of a shield. So it does it in the sense that I can get attacked for resources. So I always keep my resources low, under, you know, basically as high as my vault will protect it. But even then, guys, because we are in this war with another, so I'm in Omega in this war with this guild called Jedi. Jedi, just as soon as they find me, and I guess they get mad that they port and they attack me and I don't have anything, I'm pretty much empty. They will like literally hit me until they break my wall. And when that happens, it automatically ports you to another part of the kingdom, which always makes me laugh, because then I also get a 24-hour shield and I'm like, thank you. Like, yeah. So it is what it is. What I was showing you there before is that's a seat of power. That's what it looks like when it's active and you're basically fighting for it. Another thing to mention that's pretty cool is when you are attacking, they give you the opportunity to select what your army is going to look like via the pawns that you see. They're almost like chess pieces. Right there you see a red three-headed dragon. That's the Targaryen pawn. They're kind of like walking towards the dragon. You see kind of that X. That's actually the Bolton's flayed man. So if you see it from the front, it looks like super scary because the guy's like all red and bleh. Like, if you know what flaying is, that's like not a good look. So that's kind of it in a nutshell. Wanted to show you guys though war. So 3 weeks kind of after the server opened, they opened PvP, and this is almost for those of you guys that are Lords fans and even Iron fans. You know, think about it as KvK, where you're fighting kingdom versus kingdom. In this case, it's inter kind of kingdom fighting. So PvP, it's basically within your kingdom. You're not porting to another kingdom. And it is absolutely, and everybody calls it this, the purge. I would say anyone under a couple of mil of power was totally shielding or trying to shield. I found a lot of shielded castles. But again, my job is to pressure test games, right? And see what can I do, given the fact that I've played a lot of these types of games for years now. Would I be able to participate in PvP with a couple armies, not necessarily super strong troops? Given that I'm also in a warring alliance where I'm, you know, if the other alliance finds me, some of the, I would say various alliances that don't like us, right? Like, I can get soloed, and they know that based on my might. It's low. I don't have a lot of troops, right? So I'm not sitting here, just to kind of level set for you guys, like a million troops in your keep is a lot, right? But 100,000 isn't, and I'm like at 100,000, I'm soloable. But still, I was able to participate in PvP. I was able to score at the end of the gig 4 million points. I was super excited about that. It's four times my might, and I don't have a lot of troops. And anything that I found that was just way too big, like I would just post it for my alliance for them to get it. So we ended up winning the PvP event, which had really, really amazing prizes. So that's always really great, right? When you're part of such a strong alliance that you do really well in the events. And by doing well in the events, it basically helps all your alliance members. But obviously, every single person in the alliance needs to participate and needs to try to be as active as possible, but being smart. So when I was playing here, like you can see, guys, I'm not speeding or slowing this down at all. I wanted to give you guys the real-time view. It is slow. Now, I cannot speed up my marches while I'm attacking. You guys know, right? Like, so much of, like, Lord's Mobile, for example, is about timing, right? Like, you speed it before they shield and you do all this stuff. Like, you can't really speed here. Here, this is, I'm just showing you guys what a scout report looks like. So the guy has no resources, but he does have troops. So obviously I'm going to attack, but I don't have an opportunity to like attack and then quickly send my troops out or quickly bring them back. So what I was doing because of that is I tried to make sure that I constantly had my troops like out of my castle. Like I was pretty much empty at all times because I knew that at any moment I could have visitors port next to me and try to solo me, right? So you have to be, when you're offensive and you're small, you have to also play defensively. And that's something that I try to teach you guys when it comes to the other games. It's important and it makes it harder. Like I will always say, if you're smaller and you're trying to still get kills, right, and still help your alliance, it means you can't be sloppy. Like I have a Titan size account, right, in Lords, so I can be as sloppy as I want, honestly, right? Like nobody's gonna solo me. Like maybe I'll get like quintuple rallied, but nobody's gonna try to solo me. But if I'm a smaller account, I just have to be so much more kind of like on the ball, and it makes it so much harder. So I have so much respect for you guys that do play on those smaller accounts and still manage to participate and still do well, because it just means you're, you know, ultra vigilant. Now, I've been playing this game now for a month about. I really like it, but I'm in this place where I have a lot of games that I'm playing and I don't know if I want to keep going. So you guys let me know in the comments what you guys think. Are any of you guys playing it? Do you guys think I should keep playing it? Are you guys thinking about starting to play it? What do you like? What do you don't like? Help me make up my mind because I'm not quite sure. And I know some of you guys, or a lot of you guys, are going to be like, no, forget it. Just stick to Lords Mobile, which I appreciate. So you can let me know that too. Thank you so much for watching. And as usual, let me know if you have questions down below. Thanks so much.